Good. Hey, good morning, everybody. Sorry for the delay, especially with our folks there online. You don't see, but we are gathered here, but we're just trying to figure out a couple little technical issues with the audio this morning, but glad to have you with us, and thanks, everybody, both online and here in person, for your patience this morning. Glad to have you supporting here at St. John. Just a couple of announcements that I'm going to highlight this morning, and the first of those is that today at 12 o'clock noon, the youth and any other who would like to join us are going to have a bring your own lunch gathering here in the courtyard, and we'll be kind of socially distanced but eating our lunch together in fellowship, and then go on the crop walk. As many of you know, the crop walk is something we do here annually in the city and the community of Waynesboro, and St. John's is very blessed to participate in this endeavor as well, but this is going to all be done a little bit differently this year. Instead of everyone gathering in masses and walking through town, we're all, as teams gather together, they're doing their walks separately and on their own. And so our St. John's team is going to gather here at 12 noon today with a bring your own lunch, and then we're going to walk the Greenway together as a community. So if you'd like to join us, you're welcome to come back about 12 noon, bring your own lunch, and we'll from the courtyard, we'll start our walk for the crop walk, and that's to raise awareness and support of issues of hunger, both in our community locally, but also the community around the world. So that's today. And a shout out to Marty Sutkin, who chairs that for the whole community. So he is one of our own parishioners here, and we're very fortunate to have his leadership with that. The other announcement is that we have gotten in our Christmas stockings, and this is an opportunity for St. John's. We've been doing this annually for quite some time now, but if you'd like to participate, you can come by either on a Sunday morning or come by the church office sometime during the week, and you could pick up a Christmas stocking that will be filled with gifts for children in our community, and you would sign up for a specific child with an age range, and there's suggested gifts that come with that, and you just fill the stocking. So we have the stockings there in. If you'd like to support that, we will turn them all back in on December 1st, so you've got some time. But if you'd like to sign up for one of those, either contact the church or come by on a Sunday morning, and we can get you set up. So those are here and in. So, okay, so we got to, maybe I'll move the microphone a little bit closer. Okay, we're working out the tech stuff as we go. So thanks, everybody, for all your support and patience, and let us now prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you. psalm appointed for today is number 25, and we do it responsibly by half verse. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you. Let none who look to you take a shame. Show me your ways, O Lord. Lead me in your truth and teach me.
For you are God of my salvation, and you are my trust all day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love.
For they are from everlasting.
Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Gracious and upright is the Lord.
Therefore, he teaches sinners in his way.
He guides the humble in doing right.
And keeps his integrity in the Lord.
Our scripture reading today comes to us from Paul's letter to the Philippians. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from God, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy be complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in a full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you, as in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself, and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching. He said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another, "If you say from heaven, he would say to us, why then did you not believe? But if you say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing this thing." What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, "Son, go and work in the vineyard today." And he answered, "I will not." So they would change his mind. The father went to the second, said to his name. And he answered, "I go, sir." But he did not go. Which of the two is the will of the father? They said the first. Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going to be God, so if God takes you in the way of righteousness, you need not believe us.
speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I shared with you all a few different stories about my experiences at seminary, but in particular, I know I've shared a couple stories as it related to that time at my seminary where the chapel burned to the ground. And that was a very powerful and impactful experience for all of us, particularly who were seminarians there at the time. But the story I'll share with you today, I think, is one I haven't shared yet. If I have, I apologize. But what I'd like to share with you is the story of very shortly after they had taken the basement of our academic complex and converted it into a temporary worship space, we had a gathering for the feast day of the Holy Cross. And in fact, it was just a couple of weeks ago, here in mid-September, that we had that feast day. But we were gathered in this temporary space, and what was brought into the space was this very lovely, ornate cross that hung behind the altar area and that was kind of central to our worship there. But what was interesting was the very first sermon that was delivered there by one of the professors as it related to the veneration of the cross was actually not what the cross itself, but what was just off to the side of the cross. And if we were in that space, and this morning we did worship in the parish hall with the 8 o'clockers, and I was able to point it out, but just off to the side of the cross in that temporary worship space was a big red box on the wall that had a flashing light built into it. And you might recognize or recall that is the light and the siren that would go off if there was to be a fire. And so for us to be gathered in this temporary space following the burning of our chapel, and seeing where everything was lined up in that temporary space to keep the cross central to our gathering, we also didn't really notice that the fire alarm was just off to the side of the cross. And what the professor preached about that day was about how that cross, as ornate and lovely as it was also a reminder of trauma, a reminder of pain and difficulty, and yet we have it elevated to commemorate its own feast day, that of the cross. And when he held it in juxtaposition to that fire alarm, it became very real to all of us gathered in that space of that experience of trauma that we suffered of losing our chapel. Our chapel burned to the ground. It had essentially died a tragic death. Well, as we relate to the cross as both this ornate, lifted up, celebrated symbol, we also have to remember that it is a symbol of trauma, a symbol of death, a symbol in which our Lord took upon himself that of a criminal. And so, when we think about this, we have to carry this tension between the celebration of what the cross represents, but also the pain from which it was born. In today's letter from Paul to the church in Philippi, it's interesting to note that one of Paul's most encouraging and uplifting letters comes while he is in prison. It comes towards the end of his life after he has suffered he has gone through great suffering for the sake of Christ and the sake of the gospel. And so he is in prison, and yet what he offers to the church in Philippi is a message of encouragement, a message of hope, a message of uplifting. And what's planted in the middle of today's passage is one of the most ancient and earliest of hymns of the church. It's called the Christ Hymn. And if you open it up in your Bible, you'll see that the way that the print is put in there looks different than everything else around it. Today in our bulletin, it's in paragraph form, and so you can't really pick it out. But if you look at it in your Bible, you'll see it very clearly. But in this hymn, it is a celebration and a recognition of how God in Christ Jesus gave up that elevated status, poured out his life, and even to the point of death on the cross, and yet he is glorified and raised up. And so too in Paul's message to the church, that we are to recognize there is suffering, there is loss, there is death, and yet for the sake of the gospel, it is also life. That is the message of the cross. And as I think back to that temporary chapel, that temporary space of worship for our community at the seminary, and that fire alarm right next to the cross that was there to remind us of the chapel burning down, how powerful that was. That we look at something like the cross, and we elevate it, and we venerate it, and we celebrate it, but we can't lose sight of the fact that it is also a sign of loss, a sign of death. And in that mixture, we find hope. We find new life. We find the message of God giving God's very self to bring life to us. So as Paul does to the church in Philippi, the invitation is there to recognize and to look at where suffering exists, where loss exists, and then to pursue life amidst that, to bring life out of that. There's no shortage of struggle in our world today and in our lives today, that is for certain. But neither either is the message of the gospel any more diluted. It is so potent and powerful for us today to find life, even when we are discouraged, even when we are down. And that is the body of Christ is our mission, to be like Paul, to be like Jesus, and to pour out our lives that others might find life through us. Amen. We'll continue now with the prayers of the people in your service bulletin. Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons, remembering especially Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Mark and Keith, our bishops, Benjamin, our rector, and Brian, our deacon. Pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, remembering especially Donald, our president, Ralph, the governor of our commonwealth, and Bobby, our mayor. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. Today we pray for the deacons of the Diocese of Southwestern Virginia and our Archdeacon, the Venerable Bill Baumgartner. We also pray for the Right Reverend Nicholas Baines and the Diocese of Leeds, the Episcopal Church of Sudan, and St. Mark's School in Circle of Source, Haiti. Remember our friend in mission, the Right Reverend Patrick Augustine, Assistant Bishop of the Diocese of Bor and the Episcopal Church of South Sudan. We also pray for all the healthcare workers and essential employees in our community and around the world, remembering especially Emily, Bethany, Kathy, Greg, Michael, Melinda, and Julia. We also pray for all teachers and school employees, remembering especially Doris, Elizabeth, Dale, Kathy, Susan, Alex, Michael, Amanda, John, Amy, Anthony, Edmund, Betsy, Melissa, and Pam. We pray for those on our parish family's prayer list, John, Pam, Dennis, Allison, Lanique, Tim, Robin, Heaven, David's family, Helen, Patrick, Gary, Chris, the Navajo Nation, and the children and youth of our community. Pray for the safety of our armed forces at home and abroad, remembering especially Dominic, Steele, Ryan, Tim, Matthew, Carson, Nathaniel, Richard, Nathan, Jeff, Jason, Ryan, Jake, Brendan, Kyle, and Matt. We thank God for those celebrating birthdays this week, remembering especially Stacy, Walt, Christy, and JP. We also give thanks to God for those for whom God has joined together in holy matrimony, who celebrate another year together, remembering especially Bill and Edie, Victor and Sherry. Hasten, O Father, the coming of thy kingdom, and grant that we, thy servants who now live by faith, may with joy behold thy Son at his coming in glorious majesty. Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. We now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. My friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace, friends at home. And as we prepare the table for communion, let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God. Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, combined with glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Yeah, this is
the one. Blessed is he who
comes
in the name of the Lord.
Let's dance to our blanket.
Hosanna
in
the
highest.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. And for those of us who are unable to take communion at this time, we will now offer the prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. As I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart, as though you have already come. I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Thank you.
bread of heaven.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to now enjoy our post-release.